come sit.
Please take your seat. Yeah. Naam kya?
Sir, Mr. Gundar.
Okay, let me take off. Yeah. Shall we call you Raghvendra?
Yes, sir. My first name is Raghvendra.
Okay. So, Raghvendra, can you tell about yourself?
Sure.
About your academic qualification, experience, and what are you doing now?
Sure. Sir, my name is Gundar Reddy Raghvendra. I'm coming from Kadapa district of Andhra Pradesh. I did my engineering in electronics and communication engineering in 2009. Then I worked around 5 years in a telecom firm in big data analytics in Kerala as well as Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm interested in teaching children, sir. I'm a person who believes in honesty, integrity, and perseverance. Right now I'm preparing for civil services. I resigned my job recently in 2017. From 2017 onwards, I'm preparing full-fledged for civil services examination.
You had got into Indian Forest Service also?
No, sir. I have applied for Indian Forest Service. I could not qualify.
You could not. So, tell me, Kadapa is a very sensitive, politically very sensitive district.
Yes, sir.
Now, can you tell about the, after the division of Andhra into two,
yes,
and now you are going to have polls also, simultaneous polls.
Yes.
So, how do you think the decision of dividing Andhra into two has been beneficial to the people? I am not saying beneficial to politicians or any other person, to the people.
Sir, in 2014, Andhra bifurcated. Even at that time, I have a mixed feeling how the states can be survive themselves. But one can see the hindsight, the both states are equally competing in ease of doing business. Now, development is decentralizing, sir. Earlier, only development concentrated in Hyderabad. Now, the development pockets are developing across the states. For instance, Kadapa is now developing as a horticultural hub, whereas Tirupati is developing as an electronic city, Visakhapatnam as IT hub. So that's how the development decentralization is happening, sir. And both states, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, competing in ease of doing business, sir. And both states are now registering more than 10% their GDP growth rate, sir. Yes, sir. Both states are doing well in the post-verification of Andhra Pradesh.
What is this one nation, one election?
Yes, sir. Sir, one nation, one election is about simultaneous conduction of parliamentary elections, state elections, and local elections also. There should be synergy across the elections. Thereby, the development has to be given prime focus rather than one or other state going for elections. There, the politics playing important role rather than development is sidelining. So the idea is governance has to be given prime focus in simultaneous elections.
No, in what manner governance is affected if you have elections at different times? Andhra will only have twice. Now, you think that since Andhra has simultaneous polls, it is in a better position than any other state, say Madhya Pradesh or Karnataka, which has polls at two different times in 5 years?
It is not like governance is exactly. For example, sir, no parliamentary elections are going to be held in 2019, but state elections are in different time phase. Then model code of conduct will take place and then development will be halted for some period of time, whereby politics will be given importance. Then secondly, sir, due to these kind of elections, without simultaneous elections, expenditure is also given more priority rather than other activities.
Okay, then when there are so many virtues of having simultaneous polls,
yes,
then what is the problem? Why are we not having it?
Sir, the problem, sir, first one is logistics. To conduct the mammoth exercise, as election commission is conducting these elections, but conducting simultaneous elections of both state and center, and even the parliamentary elections, local panchayats, its biggest managerial task. Number two, sir, some people are raising questions that whether our citizenry able to differentiate between state elections or parliamentary elections. But it is nullified because some states, for example, Andhra Pradesh is going for both. They have given different mandates for both state and center. But people are criticizing that how can people can differentiate both state and center. these are the little drawbacks. Apart from that, yes, they can go for simultaneous selection.
So you think the drawbacks of simultaneous polls are more than the virtues?
No, sir. I'm talking about virtues are more than drawbacks.
What about the legal amendments and law which may create obstacles? What are the major, you know, obstacles in terms of the legal provisions,
yes,
for these simultaneous polls?
Yes, there are hurdles or challenges also. Yes. For example, any state went into presidential rule and other things. Then how can the state going to conduct the next elections? For example, presidential rule is imposed in a particular state. Then how can it cope up with the remaining states? The idea is also there, the solution is also there. For example, any state went to presidential rule and other thing, emergency case situations, the elections has to be conducted the remaining term, not for the full 5 years, like in happening in panchayat raj elections.
Is this your suggestion or was it posed by some body who had made some recommendations?
No, some body made recommendations.
Who is that body?
I think S.Y. Kuroshi, I am not sure about it, sir, but S.Y. Kuroshi also made this kind of recommendation.
Okay, those may have been his own comments.
Yes.
But the Law Commission gave some recommendation.
Yes, sir.
Which included this, the point that you mentioned. Alright, now tell me, what are the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals?
Sir, United Nations Sustainable Development Goals aim to achieve 17 parameters, 17 goals. It includes no hunger, no poverty, and standard of living has to be improved. These goals set as set target as 2030, sir. We need to achieve these goals. And every state, every country also meet one of the agency as a nodal agency to implement these goals. For example, in case of India, it is NITI Aayog, sir. NITI Aayog kept as a nodal agency to achieve these targets. So it is overall development of a society, sir. Women, children, and standard of living and other criteria
taken into consideration. Raghavendra, what is the significance of your name?
Yes, sir. My name is, complete name is Gundala Reddy Raghavendra. Mm-hmm. Gundala is my surname, sir. Reddy is local deity in my village, sir. My mother is deeply adored Reddamma Thalli, so she kept Reddy as my first middle name. Raghavendra is a guru, sir. He is a saint in Andhra Pradesh. My father is deeply worships that saint. He kept Raghavendra as my name.
Okay, you did your engineering and now you want to switch to IAS. What makes you switch over to IAS rather than continuing with engineering, where the nation spent a lot of money and opportunities on you?
The idea of becoming civil servant always has in my back of my mind. But doing engineering is an immediate option before any middle class family. I want to get a job immediately due to financial problems. But that is the reason I did engineering, sir. Because of engineering, I worked in a firm. It helped me to get immediately a job in a firm. I learned a lot of organizational experience. Even otherwise, also I'm a learner, sir. Yes, sir. I think it is not wasteful expenditure by Government of India on me. I will use my engineering expertise in administration as well. As administration is now moving towards e-governance, electronic governance, where the technical knowledge of an administrator is paramount importance. So that's how I think. I don't think so it is waste of money on my
side. I did not say waste.
Yes, sir.
I did not waste it. Was how was it that the government spent certain amount of money on you and now you want to leave that profession and move to IAS?
Yes, sir. It is, yes, government spent. I am accepting that fact. But I will use whatever the money invested in government.
It's fine. Can you inform me about the genesis of the Kashmir problem? Please.
Sir, Kashmir has integrated India under special circumstances, sir. In 1948, in Hari Singh. So, through Hari Singh, accession agreement taken place between Hari Singh, Sri Hari Singh, and the then Prime Minister of India. And due to that, we have given special provisions to Kashmir also, sir, under Article 370 of the Constitution. Thereby, they can maintain their own affairs except defense, communication, and foreign policy. And in 1950s, their Article 35 also, through presidential order, we have incorporated so that the citizens of Kashmir, they have the property rights, and the property cannot be transmitted if the any person marry outside, if the woman marry outside the citizen of India. The problem here, sir, is people of Kashmir feels that there is alienation is happening in the Kashmir. But the genesis of the problem can be traced to the cross-border terrorism encouraged by Pakistan. They feel that the Kashmir is belongs to them because of the sizable Muslim population and other reasons. That's how they create a kind of instability in Pakistan, instability in Kashmir. And the people of Kashmir also, they are not, in opinion, fully integrated with India for variety of reasons, due to Pakistan factor or lack of employment opportunities. All these factors triggered to create a kind of mistrust of Kashmiris with the rest of India. The problems are still continuing.
Now, on 8th of March,
yes,
we celebrated the Women Empowerment Day.
Yes,
how does that gel with 35A?
It's not perfectly gel with 35A. It's a discriminatory provision against women. As women marry any person outside Kashmir, her property won't be transmitted, her property. So it doesn't gel with the women empowerment.
Yeah,
Rabindra. Yes,
sir. Suppose you are made in charge of a landlord problem, and you know Sudimala temple?
Yes.
And that controversy also you must be knowing.
Yes.
A group of 40 ladies intending to enter the temple. So what would be your priorities and how you are going to handle this situation?
Sir, first I will make sure that the law and order has to be established. I will ask my team, my extra force has to be present in that area, so that the 40 women has to go peacefully to enter into Sabarimala temple. I will make sure that any persons who want to deliberately create a kind of disturbance will make sure that those kind of persons has to be detained in preemptive manner. Then, and also I will help the women, I will accompany any women constables, women police, to help the women to enter into the temples.
But the temple authorities are not in favor of the entry. So how you are going to handle them?
Sir, as Honorable Supreme Court has given its verdict to enter, a woman has to be entered into temples. Then I will convince the temple authorities to allow women. If they don't they don't accept my views, then I will ask any community leader who believes his words will be taken, given importance. So then I will make sure that person has to talk that temple authorities, make sure that the woman has to go into the temple.
Suppose I want to go to your state for 2 days.
Okay.
What would you suggest me to visit? I have 2 days coming.
Sir, I will ask you what are your interests. Then only I can suggest you where you can go.
I am a general tourist.
You are a general tourist,
but not interested in temples.
Then I will give a kind of suggestion for you, sir. You can go to Visakhapatnam. Visakhapatnam is having good beaches. You will enjoy the scenery of Visakhapatnam. Then you can go to our Kadapa district also. Our Kadapa is having a Gandikota, where it is also known as Grand Canyon of India. You can have good scenery there. You can enjoy your time there.
Okay, you had been a student of sociology. I am told that you had opted,
yes,
for sociology.
Yes, sir.
So, in the present day of system in the society,
yes,
we are often take that there is a lot of problems of living relationship.
Yes.
So, what is your personal opinion about this? Whether in the context of Indian culture, it should be. And there is a recent judgment also on this subject. So, how do you do you think of?
Is there a living relationship? People are going for living relationship based on their choice. We should not curtail their choice. Yes, living relationship is good because they have taken a choice because they want to they want to test before they want to go for marriage. The compatibility has to be tested before they want to go for marriage. That is the reason so many people, adult consent, both men and women are going for living relationship. So yes sir, there are some cases we have seen recent times where even women are forced to kill herself because the person is not accepting the birth of that lady. Even Supreme Court has recognized the living relationship, the rights of the people who are engaged in living relationship as the both married partners. Yes, if they have any problems with their living relationship, they can approach the court also.
No, but the girl later on alleges that the case of rape or something like that is distorting the fabrics of the society. She or he, they are living together with their consents. Okay. But after that, if that is brought down, then...
Yes,
so how do you see that?
Sir, I don't think so, sir. It is breaking the fabric of marriage. Because both two are the adult people. They have consent for them. That is the reason they are going for it.
Next.
You heard about this Me Too movement?
Yes, sir.
What is it about?
The Me Too movement is basically a social media campaign where aggrieved women, they have faced some kind of sexual harassment in their profession. They are ventilating their grievances in social media platforms.
You think it's fair, like, you know, after 15 years you come out with an allegation, you think it's fair to the other person?
Yes ma'am, there is disproportionality in this case because the woman who's giving allegation, that time the man may be having he may be bachelor. Now he is having family. The entire family has to entire family has to bear that burden. But at least we should now see it's a positive signals. Women are now raising their voice. Now any man before taking any advances, he will think twice. I should not do it.
So in the government departments, what is the government doing to curb this kind of sexual harassment in our offices and all? Is the government taking any steps?
When post Vishakha judgment, government enacted prevention of sexual harassment at workplace. Then on the top of that, government recently, there is she e-box, where women can file her complaint also on online portal. So government is also, recently Women and Child Development Ministry, they told that all the departments has to come up with how many departments have constituted the work, the committees for women redressal grievances. Yes, government is doing well now.
Which year did this Vishakha thing happen?
I think in 1980s, ma'am. Sorry ma'am, I don't know the year.
Okay,
sorry.
We'll pass that. Tell me on the international front, what is the basic dispute, why did it in Israel, why did the dispute arise?
Pardon, sir?
In Israel, the country, how did the dispute come about, you know? Why was it, you have any idea?
No, you were asking about Israel policy.
Israel, yeah, problems.
Israel policy, no?
Yeah.
But root cause, I'm not aware of it. No.
Okay.
Sorry.
But what's happening now, today, I mean, currently?
No, currently it's happening. Israel is demanding the Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. Uh-huh. But on the other hand, Palestina also have claims on Jerusalem. Okay. Even recently, USA also given its consent that Jerusalem has to be declared as capital of Israel.
Okay.
There are contestations on Jerusalem, which Jerusalem belongs to which, Israel or Palestina. And there are some terrorist groups operating from Palestina, Hamas and the Fatah, which are against Israel's claims.
Okay. So India is supporting foreign policy of India supports who? Which country do they support?
No, India is supporting both Israel and Palestine. Recently, we have changed our, there is one concept called we are trading now independently, both Israel and Palestine. We are respecting the sovereignty of Palestine. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we are maintaining the good relation, the defense relations, and other agricultural relations with Israel.
So somewhere I read in your hobbies that you are fond of teaching children.
Yes, sir.
So how do you do that?
Well, the idea is coming from my father. My father is a driver in hospital. He did not get education opportunities. That made me to inspire to teach children of my neighboring community. I teach children of my neighboring community thrice in a week.
Okay.
In the age group of 9 to 15 years of people.
Raghavendra, you mentioned about teaching children. Do you think such efforts at the level of the individual, do they really make a difference?
Yes, sir. They can make a difference. Even I got a lot of satisfaction when clearing their doubts. Even they have improved a lot. They are now into engineering and medicine, sir. Yes, at least such a beginning has to be made somewhere else. Yes, by teaching individuals at their limited capacities, they can learn something and they can contribute.
You're also a team leader.
Yes, sir.
So what are the important traits that a leader should have?
Sir, leader first he should have vision and he should have ability to lead the people. Then he should motivate people to carry that vision. Then he should maintain the trust. He should always take initiative.
Okay. And how is a leader different from an administrator?
Sir, administrator cannot initiate the things. He cannot always initiate the things first instant, but leader can initiate the things always. And administrator has to work within the framework laid down by any organization, but leader can go beyond it if anything is required.
Okay. Can you define at a very basic level the term society?
Sir, society is a group of people having social interactions within a geography, and administered by any political authority.
So, a common political authority is essential for a people to constitute a society?
It is not exactly, sir, but political authority came later. But basically, society is a group of people having social interactions within a geography.
And if a people are geographically dispersed, can they be considered as part of the same society? For example, if you are now in Delhi,
yes,
you belong to the Telugu people, so will you be considered still a part of Telugu society if you were to shift elsewhere?
No, sir.
You will not be a part of Telugu.
No, I will be treated as Telugu people only, sir.
So even geographical territoriality is not
that much constraint. It is not required to be called as a society.
Who is your favorite sociologist? Give me one Indian and one Western.
Western is Max Weber, sir.
Weber.
Max Weber. And Indian is Andrew Bethes.
Any Telugu scholar?
Indian socialist, sir.
Yes.
No, sir.
At any level, any Telugu scholar who's commented on any aspects of society?
In my limited knowledge, I did not encounter any Telugu scholar commenting.
You heard of Kancha Shetty? Kancha Ilaya?
Kancha. He's from Ayas. Kancha.
So, what are his writings?
He is basically a Dalit scholar, sir. He talked about the inequalities in society. There are criticism against Mr. Kanchalaya saying that he commented on a particular community, that is Vaishya community. So they expired in society. That is what I learned.
Can you, I presume you understand the term Sanskritization. So do you think it's still taking place in our society, or is it like an outdated concept?
I think it is an outdated concept.
So no more, you're not following any Sanskritic rituals or customs or...
Yes, sir. Sanskritization is basically about emulating the behavior of upper caste people by lower caste people, sir.
Yes.
But now the reservation and other things are happening, sir. Mm-hmm. Instead of proclaiming their backward, instead of their proclaiming their advancement, like higher rituals, they're proclaiming, I am backward people. That is what you should give reservation for me.
And any cultural traits like which the upper caste people may be imitating from the lower caste people? In fact, Kancha Elaya has written about it. He calls it Dalitization. He says Sanskritization has stopped taking place, it's Dalitization. Any instances or examples you can give us?
Sorry, sir. Looking to.
How do you contrast Indian society and Western society?
Sir, any society can be compared, sir, but the time frames will be different. Society basically compared with the women's position and marriage, family patterns in the society, and how the society, the people consciousness, rationality or values of the people and culture.
So how are Indian values, say, different from Western values?
I said Western values are post Renaissance. The values are focusing on rationality, modernity and other things. But in India, we have both, sir. Both tradition and modernity is taking place both.
Mm.
On the other hand, we are following the rationality. But on one hand, the even tradition also come into picture.
Okay.
So that's a kind of paradox we are witnessing in society.
As a student of sociology,
yes.
Can you assess the Gauraksha movement?
Sir, Gauraksha movement is basically about protecting the culture. As in Hindu society, cow is seen as a sacred animal. So some part of society, they are protecting the Gauraksha as part of culture. But on the other hand, they are taking law into their hands also in protection of this. It is resulting into cow vigilantism.
Apart from the sacredness associated with the cow, what are its, in
yes.
which other ways is it important?
In other ways, sir, it can be used for milching and ploughing our fields, agricultural fields. That's how the cow is important for us. Even the biocomposting also, the manure, the cow dung can be used as a manure in agriculture.
How do you assess the watering down of section 377 of IPC?
Sir, it is celebration of giving the choices to the people. And now everyone, irrespective of their his biology or his sexual orientation, now can it is decriminalized so that according to his choices, he can go for marital, other kind of relationships.
Has gay marriage been legalized in India?
No, sir. Gay marriage is not legalized in India. But I think after decriminalization of this act, it is responsibility.
Should we do that?
Yes, sir.
And how about, say, should homosexual couples be given the right to adopt children?
Yes, sir. There is a contradiction, sir. There is a contradiction. Even the surrogacy bill also, they have not given choices to the homosexual couples.
And should homosexuals be permitted admission in the army, armed forces? Because the chief of army, he made a statement that the civilian culture is different and ours is different.
I said before that we need to conduct in a survey, sir. Whether army is ready, whether it is army ready now to accept homosexuals or not.
So if you were to conduct such a survey even in the wider society,
yes.
Probably the likelihood the results would be negative because the society is largely homophobic.
Yes.
So should we on that basis should we not have decriminalized homosexuality at all?
No, sir. Decriminalization, yes, it will take time, sir. But decriminalization is the beginning. Now people mindset also will go to change. Even I have seen so many matrimonial advertisements also. People are now advertising we want a gay to be married, something. So it's positive things are happening in society.
Thank you.
Raghavendra, just a couple of questions before we wind up. What is disruptive technology?
Sir, any technology which have larger implications on society. For instance, mobile phones. Mobile phone is a disruptive technology through which so many other platforms are now being defunct. Using mobile phone, one can use for entertainment, for calls, for other educational activities. So that is known as disruptive.
What are the disruptive technologies which you are predicting, you know, in the future, very near future?
Sir, as an electronic communication engineer, in future the carbon, as we are manufacturing electronic components with silicon, sir. in future carbon may precede, because carbon is abundantly available in our nature, carbon may replace silica, as even carbon has having a huge surface densities, so many transistors can be put into it. So carbon or nanotechnology will be taking place as a big, so much big disruptive technology in the future.
What about blockchain technology?
Yes sir. Thank you, sir. This blockchain technology is one of the emerging technology which can also provide a wide range of applications, sir. For instance, in case of Andhra Pradesh, now using blockchain technology, they are implementing land records digitalizations, so that there will be no mishaps in, as land records is the most important thing where so many litigations are happening because of there is no transparency and everything. Blockchain technology is one which provides a decentralized the blocks, so that everyone can, the transparency can be maintained.
Okay, what is this Look East policy?
Sir, Look East policy conceived in 1990s, as we need to see our east part of South Asia, thereby the trade relations can be improved. But now this government modified it as an Act East, proactive engagement with the southeastern neighbors, even they go beyond South Asia, sir. Australia, New Zealand, Japan also. Now the territory, the contours of Look East has been changed.
So, thank you, Raghavendra, and you can proceed,
yes,
for 5 minutes, and we'll call you back to give our, you know, review of your performance,
yes,
and give you some tips. And if you have any questions, you can ask also.
Thank you.
Thank you.